Good day, students. I am Professor Vivek Kulkarni from S&D College of Engineering and Research Center, Yeovil. And we'll start with our unit number 5 of the subject Architecture and Town Planning. The contents or the syllabus of unit 5 is Land Acquisition, Rehabilitation and Resettlement Act, that is LAR Act or LARR Act, UDPFI guidelines for land use and infrastructure, etc., Real Estate Regulation and Development Act 2016, and MAHRERA Act. Now let's see Land Acquisition, Rehabilitation and Resettlement Act, that is LARR Act 2013. Now what is land acquisition? Land acquisition is the process by which the government acquires private property or for public purpose. Till 2013, land acquisition in India was governed by Land Acquisition Act of 1894. Now let's see history of LAR Act 2013. The primary Land Acquisition Act was the Land Acquisition Act of 1894. Non-consultative, it was non-transparent and was paying low compensation. So large-scale acquisition of land, especially under Special Economic Zone Act 2005, so no proper grievances redressal mechanism was there. So it was need or it was built for a more balanced act. So government acquisition in about 12 categories under section 2(1) of the act were simple from consent and only social impact assessment was required. That is SI. Consent of 70% and 80% of the affected families was required for public-private partnership and private project respectively. 13 acts under Schedule 4 of the Act, through which most of the land acquisition takes place, were also exempted from consent. The compensation under these acts was payable according to 1894 old law only. The right to fair compensation and transparency in Land Acquisition, Rehabilitation and Resettlement Act 2013, which came into force from 1st January 2014. The title of the old law conveyed that its primary purpose was to expedite the acquisition of land. However, the principal objective of the new bill is fair compensation through thorough resettlement and rehabilitation of those affected, and adequate safeguard for their well-being and complete transparency in the process of land acquisition. The title has been amended to reflect this. Objectives of LAR: to provide a law which will enable the state to acquire the land of others for public purpose and for companies. Act also states provisions relating to taking over of possession and payment of compensation whose land is acquired. Provisions of the Act relating to the acquisition of land are substantive, and those related to taking over of possession and payment of compensation are subsidiary. Now salient features of LAR Act 2013. So social impact assessment: consent of families 70 to 80%, greater market rate, that is 2 times to 4 times, additional relief to SCST, restriction on fertile land, dispute resettlement mechanism, and accountability of HOD. Important provisions of the new law: compensation in rural areas would be calculated by multiplying market value by 2 and adding assets attached to the land or building and adding a solar ten. In urban areas, it would be market value plus assets attached to the land and solar ten. Illustration: suppose the market value of a piece of land in rural area is 10 lakhs. So multiplying it by 2, 10 lakhs into 2 is equal to 20 lakhs. Adding value of assets 2 lakh attached to the land, it becomes 22 lakhs. Now adding 100% solar ten, the final compensation is 44 lakhs. So a piece of land of market value 10 lakhs in urban area, a total final compensation is paid to 44 lakhs. So important provision of the new law: compensation of livelihood losers. In addition to those losing land, the bill provides compensation to those who are dependent on the land being acquired for their livelihood. To qualify for benefits under this act, the time period has been reduced to 3 years of dependence on the acquired land from high fishing rights. In the case of irrigation or hydel projects, affected families may be allowed fishing rights in the reservoirs. Share in appreciated land value. Where the acquired land is sold to a third party for a higher price, 40% of the appreciated land value or profit will be shared with the original owners. Important provisions of the new law. Consent. Consent of up to 80% of people required for private project. For PPP project, the approval of 70% of the same is mandatory. Multi-cropped irrigated land cannot be acquired unless it is for defense or emergency caused by natural calamity. Land should be returned to the original owner or state land bank if not used in 5 years for the purpose of which it is acquired. The government will not acquire land for private companies for private purpose. Exemption from income tax and stamp duty. No income tax shall be levied and no stamp duty shall be charged on any amount that occurs to an individual as a result of the provisions of the new law. The bill also proposes amenities like schools, health centers and civic infrastructure in place where objects affected people are resettled. The urgency clause should be exercised in the rarest of the rare cases like national defense or for resettlement purposes. The social impact assessment, that is SIA, has to be carried out in consultation with the representatives of the Panchayat Raj Institutes, PRIs. Reports prepared under the social impact assessments are to be shared with these representatives. Now, UDPFI standards for urban areas. Now, UDPI means Urban Development Plan Formulation and Implementation. Now, contents, first one is introduction, second one is need for guidelines, third one is urban development planning systems, fourth one norms and standards, then land use, infrastructure, physical and social, commercial facilities, recreational facilities, miscellaneous facilities, traffic and transportation, and fifth one is conclusion and references. Now, introduction. Planning is a continuous process and planning system should be such that it ensures continuity. Earlier, town planning was a piecemeal process, but after independence, the city planning experienced tremendous growth and challenges for resettlement due to political changes. Several resettlement, new industrial-based towns and urban centers were under process of planning, and masters and town planners conclude that land use plans are needed to guide development of urban centers to promote orderly development and healthy living environment. For this purpose, the Ministry of Urban Affairs and Employment, Government of India, organized a national workshop on master plan approach during February 24 to 25 in the year 1995. The research study of this workshop awarded as UDPAFI, that is Urban Development Plans Formulation and Implementation Guidelines. The need of the guidelines. The study of UDPAFI for norms and standards is needed to evolve system that is dynamic, flexible and efficient, process that is less time consuming, innovative ideas of land assembly and fiscal resource mobilization, simple and effective forms of laws, rules and regulations. Urban development planning system. It consists of a perspective plan, 20 to 25 years of duration, include maps and diagrams, state government's goal, policies, strategies of urban local authority regarding spatio-economic development. Development plan conceived within framework of approved perspective plan. Medium duration for 5 years. Proposals for socio-economic and spatial development of urban centers including land use. Annual plan conceived within the framework of development plan. Details of new and ongoing projects for local authority to implement in financial years. Necessary for fiscal resources mobilization. Plan of projects and schemes. Considered within the framework of approved development plan, include details, working layout with cost of development, source of finance and recovery instruments for execution by public or private agency. Norms and standards, distribution of land use, infrastructure, commercial facilities, recreational facilities, traffic and transportation. Developed area, now under the distribution of land use, developed area average densities, workforce and proposed land use structures of urban centers in plain area are considered. Now, urban center classification. population base, so settlement type and population mainly in plain areas and hilly areas, small town less than 50,000 in plain areas, and for hill areas less than 20,000 people, medium town 50,000 to 5 lakhs in plain areas, and 20,000 but less than 80,000 in hilly areas. In large cities, it is for plain areas, it is more than 5 lakhs and population of 80,000 and more in hilly areas. Now, distribution of land use according to developed average areas densities. Now, here again, settlement type and person per hectare, that is PPH, in plain areas and hill areas. Now, small town 75 to 125 inhabitants, in hill areas 45 to 75 inhabitants per persons per hectares. Medium town 100 to 150 PPH in plain areas, and in hilly areas 60 to 90 PPH, that is person per hectare. In large cities 100 to 150 person per hectare in plain areas, and in hill areas 60 to 90 persons per hectare. In metro cities, it is about 125 to 175 persons per hectare, and in plain areas, and the question of hill areas in metro cities does not arise. Now, comment or conclusion: the densities of medium town and large cities are considered similar for sustainability. The density of 125 person per hectare is maximum factor for small town and average for medium town, and large cities and minimum for metro cities for their identification and survival. Now, workforce. Now, workforce participation 33% of total population, industrial workers percentage of total workforce small and medium town 20%, large cities 25%, and workers density 100 to 125 persons per hectare. Now, comment or conclusion: due to more population in large cities, the industrial worker population is 25%. In current scenario, the industrial worker population is more than 30% due to setback in agricultural production. Proposed land use structure in urban centers, land use category and percentage of developed areas. Now, residential, it is 45 to 50% of developed area percentage in percentage for small developed areas. For medium, it is 40 to 45% for large cities, 35 to 40, and for metro cities, it is 35 to 40%. In commercial, it is 2 to 3% in small developed areas, it is 3 to 4% in medium areas, it is 4 to 5% in large cities, and it is 4 to 5% in metro cities. Industrial, it is 8 to 10% in medium for small scale, small developed area. In medium developed area, it is 8 to 10%. In large cities, it is 10 to 12%. And in metro cities, it is 12 to 14%. Now, public and semi-public areas percentage, small 6 to 8%, medium 10 to 10, 12%, large cities 12 to 14%, and metro cities is 14 to 16%. Recreational, for small developed area, it is 12 to 14%. For medium, it is 18 to 20%. Large cities, again 18 to 20%. Metro cities, 20 to 25%. Transport and communication, it is 10 to 12% for small developed area. For medium developed area, 12 to 14%. For large cities, it is 12 to 14%. And for metro cities, it is 15 to 18%. For agriculture and water bodies, it should be balanced for all the categories. Now, comment or conclusion: land use structure of urban center depends upon its functions and size. Due to higher density in metros, the land use for residential purpose is less compared to small areas with less density. Land use distribution for industrial, commercial and recreational purpose increases as we move from small town to metro cities. Thank you very much.